Hello and welcome to this very special edition of Faith Touch. I'm so delighted that you're able to tune in to us again on today. Well, I want to decree that this is your time and your season for the glory of God to be revealed in your life. Whatever you're going through today, I want you to know, my friends, that God has you on His mind. Well, I want you to call a friend and tell them Faith Touch is on the air. They don't want to miss this program on today. Friends, I'm so excited and delighted to have a very distinguished and beautiful lady on our set once again. One of our very own ministers, in the person of Minister Antoinette Monet Brown. Welcome to the set today.
Thank you again, Apostle. I'm so happy to be here.
Yes, you know, we were here about two Sundays ago. I do apologize. I promise you guys that we would be back the following Sunday. However, that was Independence Week, and here we are again. You know, there's been much interest garnered in the book since our last interview.
Yes, sir.
And we're back again to talk about this very, delicate subject in our communities and indeed in the world.
Yes, sir.
I have to ask you why the subject of the book is rape.
Thank you again, Apostle. Raped, like I said during the launch, it was not initially the name of the book.
Mm-hmm.
Rape was a chapter
uh-huh.
in the book.
Uh-huh.
But after the spike in 2013-14 of rapes in the country,
yes.
then I decided I needed to change the name just to
yes.
pull that out
wow.
and develop the rape story.
Wow. And
yes.
you know, and it's amazing that you've done that because, it's not an easy subject to talk about.
Not at all.
And yet you have risen, I would say, above the ashes.
Yeah.
And the Lord has done an extraordinary thing in your life. And I have to ask again, because I know that there are so many broken persons in our community like yourself who has gone through this trauma
yes.
of rape. And many of them have not recovered. And for some of them, there is no hope. Tell us again, how did you journey from the place of brokenness, torment, feeling like you were no one, to the place where you are today?
So, Apostle, I can tell you that it was so easy to just become a statistic
mm-hmm.
in your country.
Yes.
You know, you go from being Antoinette Monet Brown to number 43 rape victim in the country. So the thing is, you go through so many things in your mind. It's a mind battle.
Yeah.
And once you do not get the help and support that you need, chances are you will not come out of your situation.
My God.
So my thing was, I was sick and tired. And for things to change in your life, actually, you have to get sick and tired of
uh-huh.
doing something.
Yes.
Doing the same thing and getting the same result.
Yeah.
And so I got sick and tired of the same thing, nothing happening.
Mm-hmm.
So that is when I said I needed to forgive.
Wow.
I needed to forgive in order to move on.
Mm-hmm.
Now, that was my beginning.
Mm-hmm.
My beginning was I had to forgive myself first.
Yes, yes.
Deal with that.
Yes.
Then forgive the perpetrator.
Wow.
And then my healing process began.
Wow. So you're telling me that because, you know, that word forgiveness works in basically any situation that we face. You're telling me that as simple as it was, it's not simple, but as simple as it was, your process began with forgiveness.
That's correct.
Wow.
And as like you said, forgiveness is not easy.
Yeah.
And like I said to you last time we met, I did not want to forgive.
Yeah.
And the thing is, your human side will tell you not to forgive because it want to hold on to what is hurting you, which is not good for you. But in order for you to start your healing process, you would need to start the forgiveness of yourself. Forgive yourself for thinking that you were to blame. Forgive yourself for thinking that you really had something to do with what happened to you. And then once you forgive yourself, then you can forgive someone else.
You know, I want to ask you, what role did your family play in this? Your father, your mother, your immediate siblings, did you have the support that you needed from them as it relates to this?
Yes, my family were there from the night it started.
Wow.
In fact, that night when I collapsed, my son, my parents had to take my son, and I really didn't know what happened to him after.
Wow.
Because my parents had to take him with them home to their place. But they were there for me, and because it was such a new thing, nothing like that had happened in my family before.
Right.
So there was no directions on how to do it, or they didn't have a guideline as to how to start or whatever. But they did their best.
Yes.
They listened to me, and they helped me through this ordeal. And I want to say thank you to them, because if it wasn't for them, really, and some very good friends, I don't know how the outcome would have been.
And that's amazing, because I think so many persons can't find the support base when things of this nature occur.
That's correct.
And I think that's where so many fall through the cracks. How was it when, you mentioned the police that gave aid to you at the hospital, but how was it with that process afterwards? Did you find the support from the police? Did you find the support even at the courts? Did you find that in your life as well?
So once the police have made their initial investigation, they have done the initial investigation, their thing now is to investigate, trying to catch the perpetrator.
Yeah.
And so it's not so much involvement with them, except on the terms where you have to go and identify the person or identify anything that they may have found out or whatever.
Right.
But initially, that initial response from the police lady was very good, Apostle. And that's the type of person that you need to deal with, persons who have suffered such trauma.
Wow.
In terms of the court system, I think the court have its rules, and the penalties are there. And I did not feel that justice was served to me, but however, it was done, and I guess the court can go by what is on the books.
Wow. So the perpetrator was caught?
Yes, sir, he was.
Ah, okay.
Yes.
Well, to God be all the glory.
Amen.
Let me ask another question. How, you know, many of our churches are not equipped to deal with persons of this nature. How did you find after, how did you come into your healing process? I know you've only been with us now since I think 2015 or so, 2014, I can't even remember.
Seven years.
Mm-hmm. Yes. Tell us, how did you begin your journey in the church where you began that healing process?
Right. So when the rape happened, I was in another church, and Apostle, the topic rape is taboo in this country.
Wow. Wow.
And a lot of people do not talk about it. And just like it happened in the days of old, like you in the Bible days, you hear of rape situation, and it, not much was done And people normally uphold the perpetrator as opposed to being on the side of the victim.
Yes.
But the church I was in, my pastor, he prayed, and he prayed for me, but there was not much reaching out or whatever. Whatever happened and to make me to get out of the situation was when I studied the word, because I was sick and tired.
Wow.
Because I went in and I studied the scripture to try and get an understanding of why, like I said, God would allow me to go through something so despicable.
Wow. And, tell us about how, because there's a word that says what the enemy meant for bad, God turns for his good. And then there is another scripture that says, "For I know the plans that I have towards you," says the Lord. Now that's difficult when you start to analyze what you've gone through. So, okay, God, is this a part of my plan? Did you at some point start to question God as to, was this your plan for me? You said your plans are good and not of evil, to give me a hope and a future.
Yes, Apostle. I certainly did. I questioned God because I wanted to find out, if you said that you were my father,
yes,
then why would a father allow a daughter to go through such a circumstance?
Yes.
And but like I said, after I went through that, and I started studying the scriptures.
Wow.
And my favorite verse in the Bible says that I can do all things.
Oh, come on.
Some things, but all things through Christ who strengthens me.
Yes.
And so that is where I got my strength from, because he says that I can do it.
Yes.
And then he says that he have plans to prosper me and not to harm me. And so when God took me, when he took me and he turned my life around, it was a whole different feeling, because it was nothing like I was going through prior.
Right.
Nothing I was going through prior, because when God take a hold of your life, everything changes.
Wow.
Everything changes.
Wow. You know, I want to ask you, did your prayer life increase? Or did you have a regular prayer life with the Lord before or after?
Apostle, I was in church.
Okay. Yeah, I totally understand that.
I was in church, right?
Yeah.
And yes, we all say that we are Christians sometimes, and then you're not fully there. You're serving, and then you're fully.
Yeah.
And so I did not have a prayer life.
Yeah.
Like prior to that.
Right.
And like I said, I was living a life that I thought was good.
Right.
And not until you come to know Christ as Lord and Savior, like
how
I do now.
Right.
Like how I know him now.
Yes.
Yes. Yes. I didn't know him like that back then.
Right.
But because I didn't have nowhere else to turn.
Yeah.
I turned to the scriptures, and that is what got me through. And turning to the scriptures, I learned how to encourage myself and how to speak to myself, positive things into my life. Because while I was going through, Apostle, I could not find anything positive to speak to myself. I could not just encourage myself.
Wow.
It was that hard for me to not be able to find something to say, you're going to be better today. Or today going to be a better day, or something like that. You know, people would come to me and they would say things like that. But because of what I was going through, I couldn't see beyond that.
You know, it's amazing because, you came, when you came and you joined our ministry, you totally kept that from us. And, many Sundays that I would preach, you would say, "Wow, you were talking to me today." And you say, "One day, Apostle, we're gonna sit down together and I'm gonna tell you my story." I had no idea that your story was this. And I'm amazed. I must say that God truly has done a tremendous thing in your life in terms of growing and developing you, because you were able to keep that, but at the same time you kept a smile on your face, and you became one of our ministers and began functioning as if nothing has ever happened to you. And I want you to speak to someone, just 30 seconds, who may believe that their life is over, that there is no hope. Is there hope for that person once again? And I got to tell you, listen to me. You've got to get this book. You've got to get this book. Exuma, you got to get this book. And I'm saying, here's what I'm saying. You may not have gone through the experience, but you know someone who has. Listen to me. This book is a gift for you to liberate you, to cause you to bring someone else who is in that place of rejection, that place of low self-esteem, feeling as if they were to blame. You've got to help them. Grand Bahama, come on, Bimini, Inagua, we're going to get this book out to you. For those of you in Exuma, you're going to go to Minister Michelle in Bristol in Georgetown. We're going to get this book to her immediately. Listen, everybody, those of you in New Providence, I'm asking you, be a blessing to someone with this book, because I promise you, you're going to help so many young ladies who are broken and don't know what to do, no one to talk to. Let me say, this book is going to be that person. This is going to be their personal friend in the room, someone that they can identify with. And then, of course, the ability to call her after and say, can I talk to you for a moment? Will you pray with me? Because I want to say to you, this is your ministry.
Hallelujah.
I sense God is taking you to new heights and depths.
Yes.
Around the world.
Yes, sir.
You're going to be able to share the word of God and the prophetic into the lives of people who are broken.
Yes, sir.
Take 30 seconds, because in a moment we're going to share a clip. You have become, they have no idea what the Lord has done in your life. And I am amazed that I sit under your ministry as you sit under my
yes,
ministry.
Sir.
And I'm saying, like, she's got to be kidding. But it is amazing. I say to all, equally as God delivered me from all of my troubles and, my wickedness back in the day. Listen, man, God can deliver anybody from brokenness. And I want to tell you, listen, this woman of God is here to help someone.
Yes, sir.
Yeah.
I want everyone out there to know.
Yes.
Especially women and girls, that you may be hurting right now.
Yeah.
And no matter what you're going through in terms of trauma,
yeah,
God is there. He is there to help you. Look, he calls you above and
wow.
not beneath. He
Come
calls
on.
You the head and
Come
not
on.
The tail.
Come
he
on.
Calls you a lender
Hallelujah.
And not a borrower. And he
Hallelujah.
Calls you a child of the King.
Yes.
And so if you are the child of the King, then God takes care of his own.
Yes.
And so it doesn't matter what you are going through right now. There is hope.
Yes.
There is hope. Know that God is with you at all times.
Yes.
He is never, ever will leave you alone. That's his promise to you. And know that whatever you need in Christ, he will supply. That's his next promise. And so I want you to know that God is there to help you throughout this crisis. And he will bring you through.
My God. Listen, this is just such a wonderful experience for me. And I don't know, you've just been such a tremendous blessing in my life.
Yes,
and I'm grateful for the life that you live. I want to ask you, since that time, How difficult has it been for any kind of relationship in your life as it relates to a man?
Well, it's funny you ask that, Apostle.
Are you ready to love again?
Well, it's been a long time, and
yes.
And I can stand here today and tell you that I had a relationship after that, but they were meaningless.
Oh wow!
So I decided back in 2016 that I would take a moment and I would get to know me again, and I would ask God to show me me.
Wow.
Let me see if
powerful.
I would date me.
Wow.
You know, and so I
that
have been
amazing.
I haven't been on a date since 2016.
Oh my God.
To this day.
Yes.
And so my thing is, I had to get to know me again. I had to know if somebody out there would, if I would date me.
Wow.
And they would be, and I would be comfortable.
Wow.
And so once I got myself straight, knowing that I am ready, the good thing about God warming my heart again is that I am ready. I think I am ready to do it, to love again. And so I think God has healed me from what I've been going through, what I've been feeling.
My
so,
God.
Yes,
Praise
I am
God.
Ready.
Well, listen, I can't, we're practically out of time because I want to show you a clip of what God has done in this woman of God. So for those of you out there who've been traumatized, whether you're a woman, whether you're a young lady, a young girl, or even a man or a young boy, I want to declare to you that there is hope. I want you to sit back and watch this excerpt, and we'll be right back with you in a moment. God bless.
Genesis chapter 49 verse 15 speaks to Issachar making himself comfortable though. He saw a resting place that was good. And the land, he said, was pleasant. Issachar literally stayed in that place. Like a donkey, Apostle.
Yeah.
Like a donkey. And refused the new glory. He refused his new promotion. Do you know what happened to his tribe? They became slaves at forced labor. Why? Because they got comfortable. When you get comfortable in your zone and you don't want to move, you will miss what God has for you. Amen? Church, can I tell you today that when you align yourself with God's timing, we will experience his presence and he will make provisions for you. You will feel as light as a feather because you are able to cast your burdens upon him. Hallelujah. But if you delay, I say if you delay, God forbid, and don't move in God's timing. I know this feeling all too well. See, because I've been through it. You will feel the heavy loads. You will become burdened. And you will feel bound from fear. Fear will cripple you. The only constant in life is change. Hallelujah. See, there are people who have lost years of their lives and are still licking their wounds, dwelling in the past. They are stuck there, still trying to forgive someone who hurt them. If they could just let it go. Let it go. Whatever it is, let it go. Whatever bondage you are carrying, let it go. Hallelujah. You see, you could be powerful, people, up to date with your walk with God, and up to date with God's purpose for your lives. But can I encourage you not to get upset about what you have lost in the past? Because what's waiting for you is something greater. Hallelujah. It's waiting for you is greater. Don't worry about your past. You see, what's in the past is in the past. You need to move forward. You need to move forward in grace. Move forward and forget the things of the past. Hallelujah. See, Jesus knew the times, and he moved according to the plans of God in the right time and in the right season. I pray that if you get anything from this message today, let it be that you seek the Lord, that he may give you, by his grace, the spiritual eyes to know, like Jesus did, the times and the seasons to move according to God's timing. You see, time has its value. You will know that if it's a time for tilling the ground, you will ask God for patience. Hallelujah. If it's time for planting seeds, you will be asking God to send rain. Hallelujah. If it's time to pray, you will ask God to intercede in your life. And if it's time for harvest, you will be asking God for the laborers. Hallelujah. If you don't reposition yourself during or after a crisis, you would miss out on the best time of your life.
Well, I hope you've enjoyed that excerpt on today, and I pray that you would call and get your copy of this book. Listen, call the church at 341-0502 and make sure you let us know you want to be a part of this ministry. And that is a blessing to someone out there who's going through this brokenness. Minister Antoinette, please give them your information just one more time.
Yes, so you can contact me at 557-2110. That's a text number. Or you can call me at 422-5475, a cell number. So just know that you can always find a shelter out there to go to.
Amen. Well, listen, until next time, this is Apostle Phalmon A. Ferguson saying, this is our year of divine promotion. Look forward to seeing you on next time. God bless you.
Thank you for listening to our program today. For prayer, counseling, or encouragement, please call us 341-0502. Send us an email, united.faith@yahoo.com. Or like us on Facebook, United Faith Ministries International. We would be delighted to hear from you. Wishing to fellowship with us? Meet us at our sanctuary, number 126 Fire Trail Road East, off Samila Butler Highway, every Sunday morning for our divine worship service at 9 a.m. For all other service times and broadcast schedules, visit our website, ufmi.org. On behalf of our senior pastor, Apostle Phalmon Ferguson, and the family of United Faith Ministries International, thank you for sharing with us. Join us next week on this station, and remember, we walk by faith and not by sight.